Today on Cryptic Mass Guitar, I take you through the somewhat boring and not that impressive first impressions of the EVH-5153 Stealth, which I recently acquired. So these are just my first impressions. Amp's been out for a very, very, very long time. A lot of people don't think it's actually made anymore. But I'm just gonna take you through what I generally do when I get a new amp. It's not like super crazy or anything like that. There's just a lot of recording involved, and I generally don't look for, like the best tones or the best settings at all. I kind of just do specific things so I can learn the amp. And the first thing that I do might annoy some people. I grab a boost, generally an Ibanez TS-9, because I'm lazy, and I just want to hear how it sounds with like a boost setting through a few different speaker cabinets. So we have a V30 loaded Engel XXL vintage 4x12 cabinet, I think it's an E412, a C90 loaded Mesa Boogie rectifier oversized standard slant 4x12 cabinet, and a Marshall 1960A 4x12 cabinet that has the G12T75 speakers. When I do that, I don't do anything completely scientific. I just point the microphone 11 inches away off axis, point it almost directly at the cone, again, off axis. I'm using a Neumann TLM-107. The reason I don't use an SM57 and I use a condenser microphone is that I used to do a whole bunch of tests with microphones just to see which one I prefer to get the sound that I'm looking for. The sound that I generally hear from cabinets. That's why I use a TLM-107 rather than like a 57 i5 or like an E609 or anything like that. After that, I generally try to get channel 3 or whatever like the highest gain channel is, and grab a guitar that's either in drop A or drop A sharp and get like kind of, it's gonna probably sound scooped to some people, but it's not. It's just a lot of low end focus because of the dropped tuniness of the guitar. And again, we're still using an Ibanez TS-9, and I just like to do a recording. After that, we still have the Ibanez TS-9, and we're going to switch to channel 2. We're going to go drop C. That way we're, you know, raising things a little bit. And I like to get something a little more mid to high-end focused rather than, you know, with a lot of low-end to it. I generally keep the same type of settings from channel 3 to channel 2 just so I can kind of gauge how they sound. Again, we're not going after like the tightest sound or the, you know, the best sound. I just want to hear how the amp sounds. Again, still with an Ibanez TS-9. I know it's stupid. We'll be right back. now that we've done those two recordings there, like, I'm just gauging how the amp is kind of, I know it sounds stupid, but making me feel, or, you know, what sounds I think I can pull out of the amp. After that, I like to actually hear what the actual amp sounds like in comparison to a boost. So what we'll do a boost setting with the TS9, then we'll hear the boost off, just the settings that I'm using on the amp. It'll definitely sound a lot more full when the boost is off. Then we'll grab a SD1, a Boss SD1, the Super Overdrive, use the same settings as the TS9, then we'll turn it off and hear how it sounds again. Again, it's going to sound a lot more full because we still have that low end pulled up and everything. And then I will somewhat dial in the sound a little. So what I'll do is I will increase the gain, turn down the low end, and just like kind of bring the high end up a little more as well. Won't touch the middle or anything. And then we'll go back to the original unboosted setting. The reason I'm doing this is I don't know why, like I always kind of feel that with a boost, I play a little more progressive, if that makes any sense. Whereas if I don't play with a boost, oftentimes I use a lot more chords. And I just kind of get a little bit of a chunk sound. When using a boost, you can sort of tame the low end so it doesn't sound as flubby as it may with the low end up so much. But at the same time, it's not going to sound as full in the overall mix if you're using a boost. So that's kind of what I'm gauging here. And that's why a lot of people do tend to use a boost in front of the amp. It's just because you can tame that low end and you feel like you have a little more control over it. And it gives the bass a little more, if you're recording with one, which I'm not, a little more room in the mix, and the kick drum as well. So let's just go ahead and hear that. So we are going to get into what normal people actually do when they get a new amp, but that's just kind of not what I do. A lot of the stuff that I do is recording focused rather than, you know, like, oh, hey, what does this sound like or what have you. So that's why I often use double tracked or double track with a lead along with drums, just because I'm kind of gauging how it'll sound when I generally use the amp. So we are going to kind of go through like each channel and wiggle around the knobs a little bit so you can kind of gauge how that sounds. That is generally the last thing I do, which is kind of what most people do. Most people will sound, you know, grab the amp and put it on whatever channel they bought the amp for and get that sound that they're looking for and go, yeah, that's great. What does everything else sound like? I don't generally do that, it's just really stupid. But I do want to talk about how this amp is kind of working out for me so far with the initial testing that I'm doing. So I've owned a 5153 6L6, the 50-watt version, for a long time. I've actually had it for a lot longer than I should have, because I have sold it to Kevin, the other guy in this channel. But he keeps going, what about shooting it out with this? Or what about shooting it out with that? And he's allowed me to have it a lot longer than I should. And we're still waiting for me to do like a full-on review with this so I can use that in a video. And then I can finally send it out to him. But so far, just that extra headroom to actually have with the 100 watt just seems to give me a slightly fuller sound, even when boosted, in comparison to the 50 watt. And the fact that each of these channels are individual channels, individual EQs to them, with individual resonance controls on the back, which, by the way, I generally do keep the resonance either at noon, or I dial it back to about like 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, and I keep it there. I'm not someone that, like, I do find that the resonance control, especially on 5150, is very important to the sound, but it just sounds really, really good either at noon or 9 or 10 o'clock. You don't really need to bring it up so much because it's a guitar. It is something that, like the amp itself, it just has, I don't know, it's with channel 2, you can get a really good sound. Channel 3, the lead channel, maybe that is something that, you know, because it does have a lot more gain built into it. And it's something that sounds really good as, you know, playing leads, or just something that... you know, we'll just give you a little more gain if you feel that you do need it. But channel 2 does seem to have enough oomph to it to be like a main rhythm channel, which is fantastic, and which is probably what the amp is designed to do. I will learn a lot more about this amp and how I kind of interact and react to the amp with doing more high gain shootouts. So putting this up against a dual rectifier, a Mark V, even a Mark IV, some Marshalls, and the Engels, and the VHT Pitbull that I have. Maybe even if Kevin can coax me to do it, the 5153 50 watt before I send that out to him, that'll kind of give me a lot more information on how the amp dials in and how the amp will benefit me in the uses that I use it. So, but it is, the 5150 to me, it is an amp that I've always wanted to own, like the Stealth version, the 100 watt, just because having a 100 watt amp, just for me, it just gives you a little more headroom and a little more control on the overall sound. Versus the 50 watt, which the 50 watt, I think the 5150 series is the 50 watt to the 100 watt, especially the Stealth version with the actual resonance controls, whereas the original, or as they say online, the OG, doesn't have the resonance controls unless you mod it. Just gives you a little more control over the sound. But the 50 watt to the 100 watt is, it's not necessary to get the 100 watt. The 50 watt will absolutely do. That's why a lot of people get confused when it comes to the 100 watt by thinking they don't make it anymore, because they never see it in stores, because everyone just buys the 50 watt because it's absolutely enough. But yeah, so far my first reactions are just, I'm very happy that I finally own it. And wow, this thing does not have a clean channel. The channel one here, you have to have it so there's like absolutely no gain, and bring that volume up, and you know, it kind of does the clean thing, but not as much as the 50 watt does. The 50 watt, you can coax out a nicer clean sound, and the EL34 version has a nicer clean channel than this one here. So if you're buying this one for the clean channel, just buy a separate amp for the clean channel and switch it that way. Anyway, here is what everybody else does in their videos, and what normal people do when they buy an amp. We go through each channel and wiggle around the knobs and go, oh, that's what that sounds like. Thanks for watching.
Thank you.